Thank you. Today, a number of things have come to mind, but not least of which is the homework assignment from 2 weeks ago, and we talked about it last week. If you're new to the church or visiting, just want you to know that I'm very flattered that you have a creed on the wall, Apostles' Creed, and it was the honor of 10 years of service, that I might be remembered in my time here at St. John's, not that I'm leaving anytime soon, but in my time, unless you shovel me out the door, and I don't know, but long holiday coming up, very long holiday. The Apostles' Creed is an important piece. Are we grounded in the creed? The other piece, though, if you could say one thing about what I emphasized in ministry over the years, is this: is the sovereignty of God. It's huge. And I've been preaching about that all month. I've been preaching about, from Karl Barth, great theologian, about the centrality of the Word of God, the centrality of the sovereignty of God, and how do you respond? So the homework assignment was, how are you doing with that? Anybody want to share how they had it? I'm not expecting a flood of answers, but how does it feel to spend your day, instead of initiating with God, responding to God? It's a huge shift, actually. It's a huge difference. There's a whole waiting thing that goes on. Anybody want to comment? It seemed that God wanted me to do much less. And everybody said, amen to that, right? And that feeds beautifully into my sermon today. So thank you. I didn't even prime that. Early retirement. Okay, so let me turn to Scripture. I want to read something to you. Maybe you can follow along. And it is from Mark chapter 6. It's actually 30 to 34. I'm not doing all from verse 3. Mark chapter 6. But before I do, maybe I'll just tell you what was going on. Jesus, if you're not opening your Bible and following, I'm just going to tell you. Jesus is with his disciples. He sends them out two by two to do ministry. How do you feel about me sending you all out two by two to do ministry? Go grab your Bible, go knock on some doors. Let's all be Jehovah Witnesses. No, thank you. Don't want to do that. But the point is, you are called to ministry. You are called to go out. And that's what they do. And they come back and they're exhausted. Because ministry is quite emotional. But someone needs to hear the gospel. Someone's got to proclaim the gospel. So by the time we get to verse 30, so much has happened. But here it goes. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him. I'm reading verse 30, chapter 6. The apostles gathered around Jesus, reported to him all they had done and taught. And then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. Verse 32, so they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But the crowd kept coming after them, eh? They had been so effective. People were actually seeking the disciples. The text is going to move to Jesus, but if you read closely, the disciples were being so effective. You were being so effective. But many who saw them, those are the disciples, leaving, recognized those guys over there, ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. And when Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, Jesus had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And so he began teaching them many things. Here ended the lesson. Much more here, but I want you to know that Jesus didn't go off there and heal them. He went and taught them. What I want to do today is teach you something. I want you to feel a deep conviction, not just here. I want you to have a deep conviction in your heart. If I have not succeeded, it's my concern, but I hope that you will leave here going, I need to really start to understand this teaching. And this teaching is this: Sabbath rest. That's the peace. We don't take it seriously enough. I have a really corny story I told about 4 or 5 years ago. I love it so much I'm going to repeat it. There's a man driving down a lonely road, and he sees a car on the side, and there's a woman looking at a flat tire, and there's not a lot of traffic going by, and he feels compassion for her, so he pulls over, and she says, "Oh, thank you, sir." And he gets out, and it's hot, and it's a summer day, and he's sweaty, and he's jacking the car up, and he changes the tire, and he's putting the new tire on, and gets the bolts on. It's a bit of an art, and he starts to do it, and just as he starts to lower the car down, which is like, she said, "Excuse me, sir, could you just be gentle with that, because my husband's asleep in the back seat." Now, the guy in the back seat knew how to take rest. And maybe he was on his Sabbath and he didn't want to do that. Here we are in summer vacation time. As the crowd indicates, many of you are away at the cottage, right? There are many people away. I get that. And that's okay. And that's actually a good thing. I encourage you to take that time away. Everyone needs a break, time to renew and relax. But the word is out. North Americans take less time off and enjoy fewer days of vacation than just about any industrialized nation in the world. Research I came across was speaking about Americans, but I can assume that it applies to Canadians every bit as much. Average North American takes about 2 weeks vacation in the summer. How many of you have ever been to Paris? Put up your hand. Wow, big number. How many of you have been to Paris in August? What do you notice about Paris or France, let alone England or Germany? But I'm just picking on France. No Parisians. Exactly. There are no Parisians in Paris in August. The place closes down. If you have car repair and you are in France and it's August 7th, wait till Labor Day and you might get your car done. Okay? They close down all month. Gone. Bakeries closed. The streets are closed. Nothing's happening. There's something actually healthy about that. And when you look at productivity, which is something that we worship here in North America, and the growth of the GDP and the gross domestic national product and so on, we need to produce. The economy rests on it. Well, North Americans, their productivity is only marginally ahead of the French or the British. I think we might be better off if we learn how to rest and take some time off. So that's a nice, easy sermon to preach, isn't it? Right? Trust me, there's a twist coming. And actually, it's hard. It's much more profound than we might know. May I suggest that God sanctifies your time. If God doesn't sanctify the time, you won't get sanctified. Just coming to me now. One of the greatest lies there is about parenthood is being with your kids. And I'm the husband and I'm working and I got to go home and because I have to have quality time with my children. You cannot legislate quality time. Quality time happens because you spent time, and then all of a sudden something births. Something happens that creates the quality time. But you can't say, we're now having quality time between 5:15 and 6:45. It doesn't work that way. You need to make yourself available for your family. That's why eating together is so important. That's just taking leisure together. Because we need to learn that God sanctifies the time before you will be sanctified, and you need to enter into that sanctified time. I repeat from Scripture, read to you today. Jesus said this, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. There's Jesus calling us and come away to a place, get some rest, for many were coming and going and they had no leisure even to eat. That's not just for the ministry. I think that happens to all of you, no matter where you are. And they went away in a boat, because you can't be attacked easily in a boat because you're away, to a deserted place by themselves. Then word got out, and so the crowd went around by land to find out where they were in the boat and met them up. And Jesus finally had to continue to do ministry. That's why Jesus gets up early in the morning to pray, because you're all asleep. I think time gets sanctified early in the day. The earlier you're up for prayer, just doesn't happen the same way in the evenings. But that's an important piece, and that's a footnote. We have here license, permission from God to take time off. And I know that you're saying, well, I certainly heard more demanding commandments than this before. This commandment I can follow, maybe not as effectively as the guy in the back seat of the car that I just told you about. But as your pastor, my prophetic word to you is, I'm not so sure that you have really heard me or God or the scriptures. In the book series that we study called The Good and Beautiful God, you know that book series that many of us have done, one of the spiritual disciplines was sleep. I laughed, I mocked that spiritual discipline. What do you mean sleep is a spiritual discipline? Prayer, that's a spiritual discipline. Tithe offering, making financial gifts to the kingdom of God, that's a discipline. Doesn't come easily. Sleep? You kidding me? And I realized how profound it really was. I have to learn to get to bed earlier than I do, because I'm a night hawk. I will stay up. I will read. I will, because the phone generally doesn't ring late at night. And so it's just my temperament. But when I get to bed earlier, I wake up fresher and I'm more productive for the kingdom work. It takes a discipline. I have a new discipline for you today. It's called Sabbath rest. That we take the Sabbath rest more seriously. It is my experience, especially the sincere and the dedicated, earnest disciples of Jesus are, in fact, some of the worst about this matter of Sabbath rest. We don't mean to, I'm sure, but in our busyness, our ceaseless activity sometimes gives the impression that we believe that it is up to us to do the good, or good won't be done. What I'm saying to you right now is hugely profound. Not because it's for me. I've read it and thought about it and whatever. The saints have talked about this. This is huge. In weeks past, I talked about Karl Barth, great theologian. The emphasis I am leaving you with this is the sovereignty of God. So I'll just quote somebody else, because Barth said it. Hans Küng said it. He's a great Roman Catholic theologian. We do not build the kingdom of God. Full stop, no qualifier. You got that? That's radical, especially to mainline church people. We're about social justice. We are about do. Care for the poor, roll up your sleeves, get the job done. Do you see all the need out there in the world? Now be Christians, get out there and go to work. That's the clarion cry that we hear. And the gospel is saying, no. What do they say in the Lord's Prayer? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God does it. Your job is to respond. Question is, are you listening? Because we're so busy doing stuff that we think is godly. So now I'm speaking to the devout right here. If you're a seeker, forgive us for a second. It's a little in-house stuff. For those of you who call yourselves Christians, who take your faith really seriously, take a look at what's going on here. I believe it comes right out of the Garden of Eden, that we want to be like God. We have too high a view of ourselves. Don't fly too close to the sun, as I preached the last 2 weeks. God does the initiating. But the good news of what I'm talking about is that you get to rest. Quit taking so much responsibility for things that are not yours. Okay? I've said it before, I'll say it again. The Jesuit order, Roman Catholic order, there's Franciscans and Dominicans, and there's all sorts of different orders, right? The Jesuits, they take a vacation of 1 month a year, continuously, in prayer. I'm not talking about boating and golfing. I'm talking about going to a monastery and being a monk and praying and being quiet and in devotion and in solitude. Arguably, the most productive order of the Roman Catholic Church are the Jesuits. The Pope is a Jesuit. First Jesuit Pope ever. But if you measure the books that they write, the work that they do, they're prodigious. There's just so much productivity. And they work an 11-month year. Have you ever thought that the tree doesn't have the blossom unless the roots are down deep? So what does the roots down deep look like? It looks like prayer and quiet and worship. Oh, worship. You see, you're actually built for worship. Protestant land, here's what Protestant land's thinking about. Get on with the music, fine, but we're waiting for the sermon. I mean, I think there's a little bit of that in the Protestant culture. I don't know where you are. Maybe the way I preach, you're going to give me more music. I get that. But that being said, the piece is that there's a drivenness to us. There's a Max Weber Protestant work ethic going on here. We're driven. I've been saved by grace. Oh my God, God loves me that much. Now I must go do. Fair enough. But then we take back and we take on something that is not ours. None of what I've just said in the last 4 minutes is in this text prepared. It just came out there. There we are. Thus we take off. We can relish times of inactivity, reflection, and the good grace of doing nothing. Sunday worship gives us a taste of this. Here, while we do much activity of praying and singing and listening and meditating, little of what we do this morning is useful, productive, essential as the world defines these matters. We are here relaxing, hopefully resting in the sanctuary, simply enjoying being with one another and with God. It is meant to humble us. I know this flies in the face of what many of you think to be the purpose of the church. Quote, church is where we come to find out what we've done wrong. Get motivated to do the right, says a man of my acquaintance. Sometimes that is the purpose of a Sunday greeting. I come to church, says a woman I know, to get motivated for more committed service in the world. And that may be true. But will you please understand me when I say that the church is also a place where we come to rest? We come to celebrate not what we have done or even to repent of what we ought to have done, but rather to glorify God for what he has done in Jesus Christ. I know more than a few people who take pride in that they don't take vacations. I knew a pastor about a decade ago. I knew a pastor. He was retiring. He says, I didn't take a day off in 20 years, and I'm proud of it. And I said, yeah, but what was the productivity of your ministry? I didn't. I was Anglican. I kept my mouth shut. I was polite. But do you hear in that there's a self-righteousness going on there? It looks pious. You see, it's easier for me to stay at work. I've used this before, but it's just deep in me, so I'm going to repeat it. It's easier for me to stay at work till 8 o'clock at night than for me to go home, be with my spouse, be with the children, and fix the toilet that I'm not very good at fixing. And yes, I have a toilet that's not working very well at home right now, and I've got to figure it out. Okay, but it's about the time you spend. And it's that important. And Jesus says, take time away and rest. So here's the piece. We stress other commands of Jesus, to love the poor, to feed the hungry, wash each other's feet, bind up one another's wounds, bear with one another's burdens. Why not equally stress this command? How come we are so lackadaisical about this command? And I believe that at a deep self place, now this is heavy stuff, I think we're afraid to face ourselves. You see, when you sit in silence with God, sooner or later God will speak. The Trappist monks, that's another Roman Catholic order, the Trappist monks, there's a line on the wall, says there is no problem so great that it will not be solved but by silence. See, what's understood there is the sovereignty of God. Let God do his work. Sit and listen. No, but I got to get up and I got to do. Sit and listen and wait on God. For he is sovereign and you are not. So here's the piece. When you, now here, and I preach to myself every bit as much as I preach to all of you, okay? So let's get that out there. This is heavy. This is actually really heavy. Who thought talking about the Sabbath was so controversial? I believe at a deep place, not only are we afraid to face ourselves, because we might hear something about ourselves that needs fixing. And I don't want to get fixed. I love living in the pain that I've got. It's cheaper than therapy. I can just keep doing this, right? But if I sit quietly long enough, God may convict me and say, Drew, stop doing this or that or whatever. And I go, oh, really? Do I do that? Oh, okay. And there's a cleansing that happens. Here's the problem. And this is from the rabbinic tradition. Now I speak from the Jewish tradition that speaks to this. When you don't take the Sabbath, you are guilty of idolatry. Because you think more highly of yourself than you ought. The reason you take a day away and purposely not be efficient, if you ever come to me and say, I'm not coming to worship today because I have to bake the turkey for the guests, I'm going, okay, you just bought part of the lie. You've twisted this. You've changed it. You are now working. Oh, and the kids doing homework on Sundays. I got exams. I got to study. I don't believe it. I believe that you need to stop and rest and pray. Do you know in the old Christian Reformed tradition, the Sabbath was so sacred that in the family home, you didn't play cards. You certainly didn't play sport on the Sabbath. And in some homes, they took the art off the wall and turned it around so that it was just meant to just block out. Now, I'm not saying that's correct. But there's a teaching in this about where God is talking about how sacred the Sabbath is. And I'm not sure we're convicted of that. Rabbi Abraham Joseph Heschel says that if we look closely at the Decalogue, I thought this was really new and quite profound. I was talking to my son. He said, oh, no, it's everywhere. You were correcting me. It was amazing. I went, he knows stuff I just don't know. Anyway, bravo to you, Ben. He says that if we look closely at the Decalogue, Exodus chapter 20 and following in your Bible, actually it's page 51 in your pew Bible. You can go take a look at it. Maybe we should do that. Just do that. We've got time. It's important. This is important. Exodus 20. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and it was, come on, folks. God created the heavens and the earth, and it was good. He created the light, and it was good. He created man. It was good. Great woman. It was good. I have a joke there. You all know the joke, so I'm not going to do it. I've done the joke too many times. Okay. God created man, said, I can do better than that. He created a woman. Okay, that's the joke. So anyway, the point is that God creates all this stuff and it's good. When he creates the Sabbath, Rabbi says, note that he says it's holy. It's not just good. It's holy. It's another level. And that's quite staggering. It convicted me. Don't know if it convicted you. I'm just going to read from verse 8. Remember the Sabbath. I'm reading from the NIV. You got the RSV in your pew there, maybe. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Oh, 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord. It's not for you, but it is for you, says Jesus. We'll get to that in a moment. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son, your daughter, your manservant, maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. Do you know that when the Jewish people were in captivity in Egypt, they still took a Sabbath? Go figure that one. Verse 11. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. You ever think that if it was important enough for God to take a day off, maybe you ought to take a day off? Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Your text, I think, reads consecrate. He consecrated it. When we have communion, we take bread and wine, that's normal, and we consecrate. Consecrate means to set aside. This is special bread and wine. It's not just any old bread and wine. This is the body and blood of Christ. Jesus, God the Father, has done this the same with your Sabbath day. Make it holy. Now, how many of you, don't put up your hand, because I know everybody would or should and probably would, have a deep sense of reverence for the body and blood of Jesus Christ? All you devout Christians, the fact that communion is so, at this church, every week, 9 o'clock, we have communion for sure. It's that central to who we are because we consider it holy. If I'm administering the bread and I drop a piece of bread on the ground, I pick it up, I eat it, I consume it. We don't just throw it in the wastebasket. It's sacred. It's been set apart. So's the Sabbath. Do you have that same conviction for holy bread and holy wine as you do for the Sunday, for your day apart? There's one part where the teaching of the Roman Catholic Church I find is actually very helpful. I've quoted more Roman Catholics today than I have in I don't know how long, but here goes. If you do not worship on Sunday, the teaching of the Roman Catholic Church is you are in sin. You're in sin. Protestants go, yeah, this is, you know, come on, lighten up, right? So where do we get that? Mark 2:27. You don't even need to turn to it because you all know it, even if you don't know your Bible. In Mark 2:27, Jesus says, I didn't even put it on the screen. Mark 2 is, Jesus says, you were made for the Sabbath was not made for man, but man for the Sabbath. Jesus turned it on its head. Jesus said, you people, you Jewish people, are getting neurotic about the Sabbath. You're taking that so seriously that I can't even heal on the Sabbath. A little child falls in a well on the Sabbath. Would you not go and help the little child out? Would that be work? Maybe you have to hitch a wagon. Yes, do it. We Protestants kind of get that. Of course you help the little child out of the well. Lighten up, says Jesus. But he's talking to a Pharisaical culture, and what we've done is we've just taken it and misinterpreted it. We think it just means anything goes. Sabbath, you don't need, the law has been abolished, you don't need to take a day off. And you do. Here's my line that I want you to think about hard, really hard. Christ liberated us from all those regulations that look, that take the joy out of the day. But did we understand him? Did Jesus free us from the Sabbath or for the Sabbath? Big difference. You see, I believe what we've done is that I don't need to worship on Sunday. It's a day off. I'm a Christian. God doesn't mind. Jesus even said, I'm free from this. But he freed you so that you can worship. So you can enter into the holy place. Because that's where the sanctification comes. It is a command of God. It is for your good. Jesus says, or the Ten Commandments says, thou shalt not murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Let's just sit on that one for a second. Thou shalt not commit adultery. I believe deeply that he says, don't commit adultery because it's really bad for you. It might violate some standard up in heaven, but God's weeping because you're crushing your very being. You're doing stuff crazy. You're not thinking straight, and it's not healthy for you. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's possessions. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's BMW. Okay, just don't covet. It's bad for you. When you don't go to worship on the Sunday, it's bad for you. It's holy unto the Lord. It is sacred. And it's the stuff that transforms you. Sabbath rest. I think that picture kind of does it. Now, I know I'm foolish enough that if I was actually there, I'd probably just try to move the bench and see if I could hit some golf balls into the water. But that's my pathology. But the piece is, can you sit long enough? Can you sit in the quiet? Can you allow yourself to not be productive? Is the day holy unto the Lord? He gave you Eucharist for you. He gave you Sabbath for you. Honor the Sabbath. Honor God. And know that possibly when you don't honor the Sabbath, you're actually flying too close to the sun. You're pretending that you're God, that the world can't live without you for another day, that your productivity is so important that the world will come crumbling down unless you roll up your sleeves and get the job done. That's idolatry. You're worshiping yourself instead of God. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, teach us some of the depth of this holiness. That you are the creator and we are the created. That we cannot build the kingdom of God, but we certainly can respond to you and all the good things you want us to do. But we get so busy in our own worlds, in all our own activities. And we take you off your throne and we put something else on. Forgive us this sin. Teach us some of the depth of who you are. And thank you for giving us a Sabbath rest. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.